Hello, everybody. I am Randall Oliver, the Statewide Communications Coordinator for Invasive Shothole Borers. Welcome to the Invasive Shothole Borers Fusarium Dieback 2023 Symposium. As you can see from this abbreviated agenda, we have a full schedule today. There is a more complete agenda, including presenters' names and titles in the chat. I should note, though, that this symposium assumes that you already have at least a degree of familiarity with ISHB-FD. I will be quickly reviewing some basics, but it's going to be very brief. My associate, Julie Clark of UC Cooperative Extension, is dropping into the chat a handout called the California Resident Advisory. That's a document that does a good job of providing the basics if you are not very familiar with them already. So, invasive shothole borers. This term refers to two species of ambrosia beetles that visually are indistinguishable from each other. You can tell which is which with DNA analysis, but that's two different species. So keep that in mind for later with a poll and the final exam. Each species contains its own pathogenic or pre-killing fungi that cause the disease, Fusarium dieback. You should know these beetles don't actually eat the wood, but they tunnel into trees, and that's where they introduce that fungus. The fungus is actually what the beetles and the larva eat. And that fungus, along with damage that the tunneling activity causes, is what ultimately kills the tree host. And you should know that unlike many tree pests, these beetles have a lot of hosts. They can live in and reproduce in 66 different tree species that are found here in California. And that's what we refer to as reproductive hosts. The 15 species that are actually listed here in this abbreviated list are the ones that are their favorites. In particular, they love box elders, but they also are very commonly found in sycamore, cottonwood, and willows. And those are the ones that they're most likely to kill. The overall list of 66 is a very diverse list, but I should emphasize that neither it nor this list of 15 are do not plant lists. They should not be used in that way. Now, since the beetles are very small, and for the most part, throughout their lives, they're inside their tree hosts, they can be very difficult to spot. But you're more likely to see some of their signs and symptoms, which vary depending on the different tree species. They include staining, frass or sawdust, gumming, and sugary buildups, which are sometimes called sugar volcanoes. But the most important indicator of ISHB infestation is their entry-exit holes, which are perfectly round and the size of the tip of a medium ballpoint pin. So while you may see one or more of the other symptoms or signs, you must see these entry-exit holes to confirm that you have ISHB. And then on very severely infested trees, you may also see a dieback of the branches or the entire tree canopy. The other speakers have a lot of information to share today, but I also want to direct you to some other sources where you can find other information. The main thing is ishb.org, the website. It has extensive resources that include an online course, survey tool, videos, digital handouts, and a whole lot more. And then you should also check out the various social media tools that are all branded with the ISHB update label. And those include Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and then we also have our own YouTube channel, although we do also post some of our videos on the UCIPM site. So that is all that I have for my introductory presentations. And since we're already running behind schedule, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to our next presenter, who is Hannah Vasilis, She's the ISHB survey and trapping coordinator for the state of California. Hannah?
I'm going to be going over where is ISHB now, what is the general status, and what does the leading edge look like. Just a brief agenda. I'm going to go into further detail about who I am and what my position is, and then I will go county to county and focus on those leading edge updates. And then I will share some more resources and opportunities on how you can get involved in this work if you are interested. So that's me. Like I said, ISHB survey and trapping coordinator. I primarily in the past have worked with the county ag departments to get them up and running on ISHB monitoring. So that is learning how to trap and learning how to do visual surveys. My other job duties are the ISHB database and the distribution map. The distribution map is what you can see on ishb.org. The maps I'm going to show you are slightly different than the distribution map that is the public one, but if you are ever curious about what's going on in your area or any specific areas, the distribution map does have the most up-to-date information. And a new project that I am very excited about is a participatory science project. It's volunteers and leveraging volunteers to help us either in places where we don't have much data yet or places where we have a lot of trapping data, but maybe we need to find amplifier trees, for example. I really am excited to be working with volunteers because they are super enthusiastic and the data is quite reliable if they are trained well. And if you're ever interested in that, check out our site, and we will be having more participatory science events in the future. And here is a overall distribution map of ISHB. Most of the statewide trapping took place in 2020 and 2021. So the zone of infestation has remained within the southern counties that we have had it in previous years. And it just seems to be spreading and entrenching itself more within each county, except for San Luis Obispo. The find in San Luis Obispo is one catch on a trap back in 2016. And another thing to note are the distinct introductions of the Kuroshio shothole borer or the Polyphagus shothole borer up and down the coast here. And that supports our hypothesis of saying, you know, well, we know green waste can spread pests and we know firewood can spread pests, so don't do that. And also, introduction at ports is very possible as well, since each county seems to have their major ports. And let's go into a little bit more detail. And again, I will go through each county closer up just to go over the colors and what you are seeing is each county has a filled in color based off of which species of the invasive shothole borers have been found in that county. So far in San Luis Obispo, we have KSHB. And then in San Bernardino County, from what we have sequenced, we have the Polyphagus shothole borer. And then for Santa Barbara, Ventura, Los Angeles, Orange, Riverside, and San Diego counties, we have found both species of the invasive shothole borer. And since management is the same for both of these species, it is not super necessary to get every single sample genetically analyzed. Or if you're just catching beetles on the trap, a genus level identification is sufficient. And that is what we see in the purple. The purple dot is where it's just a genus level identification. Red is the polyphagous shothole borer. Blue is the Kuroshio shothole borer, and the gray, black areas, dots are where either a trap or a visual assessment of a tree, a host species, has not shown any evidence of ISHB. And we'll look closer at SLO and Santa Barbara counties. This is the northern range of the leading edge. And like I mentioned earlier, only one trap catch in 2016 in SLO, but they are still trapping quite a bit just to continue to monitor because they do have host species. And it potentially is just a matter of time. And as hopefully you know, or if you don't know now, but at the end of this training, you will all know that early detection and rapid response is definitely the best way to manage this pest. And if we go down to Santa Barbara County, they have many traps throughout the county. And in Santa Barbara County, the northernmost find is here in the Santa Ynez area. And so far, monitoring this area, haven't noticed a big increase in ISHB infestation. Where they have noticed a lot of increase is in the southern portion of the county, in Santa Barbara proper and Goleta, and as seen by the blue and the red here and the purple, they have both species of the invasive shothole borer. And Santa Barbara County has been doing a fantastic job with making sure to reach out to all of their local resource, natural resource agencies, local arborists, cities, municipalities, everything. And that is very crucial in getting a good hold on managing this pest, is this cooperation amongst different groups of people and different agencies. And now we're getting into less of the leading edge, although in these counties, the northern, this is where the mountain ranges are. So that does seem to be a natural barrier, but that is also where the leading edge is for these counties. And in Ventura and Los Angeles, it is fairly widespread throughout the whole county. And they do have both species. Also, I want to mention that there is funding from CAL FIRE to remove amplifier trees. And amplifier trees are those brood trees where they are severely infested and they can churn out tons of beetles over time. And so Ventura County has been moving along, removing, as Randall mentioned, the box elder trees are very, very preferred by this beetle, and they've removed mostly box elder trees, I want to say. And this month they have 5 removals slated. And then in LA County, it's massive, and it's also the epicenter of the polyphagous shothole borer introduction. So they have exhausted their funds from the state on removing trees, but they are working really hard on continuing to notice and manage the infestation. And right now, an area where they're seeing an increase or new evidence of ISHB infestation is in this western edge, the border between Ventura and Los Angeles counties, where the Santa Monica Mountains are. Farther south and a little bit more inland, we'll look at San Bernardino County right here, and Riverside County and Orange County. And these, Orange County has also been, like LA County, very infested for a long time. Riverside and San Bernardino also have had infestations, but they are along the leading edge, so they are noticing an expanse into the eastern parts of the county. And this pest will be limited by the desert, and it is limited by the mountains, it seems, but that doesn't mean that it can't spread beyond this range. And both Riverside and San Bernardino County are trapping and doing visual monitoring for this pest, and they are also using that CAL FIRE funds to remove those amplifier trees. And those amplifier trees could potentially become fire risks, if, in case you're wondering, why does CAL FIRE is funding this process? And that is a big reason why. And another thing to mention is there are many areas like riparian corridors, for example. The big one is the Santa Ana River watershed, where there is quite a bit of ISHB that seems to have been moving through that corridor. And moving south to San Diego County, we know, and I don't have much data, and I'm not sure if anyone in Mexico, if anyone here knows about Mexico's data collection, I'd be really interested to learn more about it. But at least on the eastern portion is the leading edge down south, and they are also seeing just an expanding and entrenchment of ISHB. And the main thing to take away from all of this is don't panic. We know how to manage ISHB fairly well, and if you are on top of it, and if you spot it early and have a really good plan, so early detection and rapid response, you don't have to freak out, you don't have to panic. But at the same time, you want to pay attention to this. You don't want to ignore this problem, because in areas where we are seeing the infestation seem to slow down a bit are also areas that have suffered a lot of damage to the urban and native forests in the area. And I just also wanted to mention some of the challenges for dealing with these amplifier trees are environmental constraints. So there are necessary things in place to prevent trees from being removed without a good reason. And some of those reasons are the nesting season or protected species or sensitive habitats. And sometimes getting that lined up with putting out a bid for a contractor to do the work and remove the trees or somehow manage the infestation in your area, that can be a big challenge. So that's why it is really important to have a good working group with all the agencies and municipalities in your area, and just be aware of the extent and the severity of your infestation. And I will wrap it up on this slide. I wanted to mention on ishb.org, we have an assessment tool. So that tool will take you through steps to help you. If you find a suspect tree, it'll help you determine whether or not that might be invasive shothole borer. And then there is the ISHB reporting tool. And that reporting tool, if you do find a suspect tree, especially if you are outside of these areas that I've shown you where we don't know if there's ISHB or not, or it's a new area potentially of infestation, the reporting tool will send a report to me, and I will be able to look at that report and pass on that information to the appropriate people that have jurisdiction over the area that you're looking at, unless it's private. But if it is private, then we still want to work on getting that infested tree scoped out. Another thing, join any local agency emerging tree pest work groups. There are some in Orange County, and they are also, you know, in LA, and everyone across the state and sometimes even the country joins and talks about different emerging tree pests. And that is a really good way to be involved. And if you are more on the volunteer side of things, the Participatory Science Project, keep an eye out on ishb.org, or you can always contact me. My email's here, and I can definitely fill you in on when the next volunteer science project is going to go on. And with that, that is my presentation. I hope I stuck to 10 minutes or around the right time.
You're very good. Thank you, Hannah. We're still behind, so I think I know there's a couple of questions in the Q&A, so you could go and answer those in the Q&A. And let's go ahead and move on to our next speaker, who is Dr. Beatrice Noboa-Berman. She's the Urban Forestry and Natural Resources Advisor, University of California Cooperative Extension for Los Angeles and Orange Counties. Bea?
Hello, hello. Afternoon, everyone. I'm going to talk about taking an integrated pest management approach to managing shothole borers in the urban forest. So let's get to it. What I will be covering in this presentation will be slightly on the IPM principles, how to prevent pest problems, how to assess and monitor pests, and then we're going to dive into control options for invasive shothole borers and brief conclusions. So when we talk about IPM, which is integrated pest management, we're talking about a science-based decision-making process that integrates what we know about the biology and how our pests interact with the environment to find a solution to a pest or a disease problem. So over here, I have the what we call the disease triangle, and some of you might have seen this many, many times, but it's always a good refresher. And the idea is that in order to have a disease, we need all of these three things. We need a pathogen, and in this case, it could be a pathogen and their vector, right? The Fusarium and the shothole borers. We need a host, basically a susceptible plant or tree, and we need the environment to be favorable for the pathogen. And so we need to have all those three angles or corners for us to actually have the disease. So IPM means managing these three corners to avoid having the disease. And ideally we would do that without using pesticides, or at least minimizing the amount of pesticides we use, with the goal of reducing any kind of risk to people or the environment. So in an integrated pest management approach, we go through all this six steps, right? From preventing the pest problems, identifying accurately our diseases and our pests. So we want to be treating the right pest or taking the right management actions for the right pest. Monitoring, getting guidelines for management action, then we'll be using cultural, mechanical, biological, and chemical control options for managing that infestation. And as this, this is the IPM pyramid shows in here, we like to do more often the things in the bottom, like prevention and cultural management, and less often the things on the top, and having chemical management as basically our last option for management of any kind of pest and disease. So when we want to prevent pest problems, the best thing is having good cultural practices. This seems trivial, but it's true. You need a healthy, resilient tree. We'll have less chances of being infested and more chances of being able to combat any pests if it gets infested. So having good soil prep, having a fertilization only when needed, not over fertilization or, you know, unneeded fertilization, having good irrigation, you know, preventing anything that is over or under irrigator, having, you know, a lot of the things that we do are not great, like having trees with the turf or shrubs growing around the tree that are competing with the tree for water and resources. In irrigation, this is a thing that I've seen a lot. So we have this irrigation spot that basically blasting on the tree trunk. And that creates two things. One is a physical damage. And the second thing is a very moist environment. And that is a perfect situation for pathogens to get into our trees and debilitate them. And lastly, talking about plant selection, as much as we can, we want to avoid monocultures, right? Or basically we want to avoid having all the same species or having only a few species in an area. When we're talking about the urban forest, we have that control. And what happens is if we have all of the species or most of the species in an area of one of the trees in an area of one single species that is susceptible to a pest, that's basically like a beam saying, hey, pests, come here. There's a lot of hosts for you to pick from, right? And so it's kind of attracting the pests to that area. And the other thing that happens is that if you have a lot of trees on the same species and they do get attacked, then if you don't manage to control them, you're going to be losing a good proportion of your tree cover. So really having a diverse tree community makes the whole thing a lot more resilient to get infested in the first place. And if you're unlucky and it gets infested and you can't successfully manage, at least you're not going to lose as much of your green coverage as if you had 50% of your trees being susceptible. Then when we talk about tree assessment for pest diseases, right, one of the main things is to accurately assess your trees and find which pest is attacking them. So the first thing you need to do is have an accurate idea of the plant or the tree species, right? That's very important just to know what things is that plant susceptible to, but also what does that plant or tree look like in normal situations or like when it's thriving? And then you can start looking for a pattern of abnormality. What looks weird, right? What seems wrong here? Is it losing leaves when it shouldn't? Is it yellowing? Is it like it's thinner, the canopy is thinner than it should be? Once you have that and it's kind of driving your attention towards that tree, make sure you do a thorough examination of the tree. Include the crown, the trunk, the branches, the root color. That can also give you an idea if there's any other factors that might be affecting the tree at the same time, on top of whatever pest or disease might have. It could have a combination of like a pest and root rot or mechanical damage that is also affecting the health or the vigor of the tree. And of course, look for other kinds of stressors in the sites, like soil conditions, or if there was some construction in the site and the roots might be damaged. And then once you kind of lean towards, okay, this looks like it's invasive shothole borers, make sure that the symptoms that you observe match what is expected for this pest. And beware that there's a lot of other diseases that might look similar on a first look. So over here, I have four examples of fungal diseases in avocado that create this staining, create the sugar volcanoes, and is very similar to what it looks for shothole borer. But when you shave the first layer of the bark, the main things that you do not see is the entry hole. So as Randall say, if you don't see the entry hole, then you cannot say that shothole borer is probably most certainly something else. So make sure that when you do your assessment and you are assigning that infestation to shothole borer, make sure you confirm that it's shothole borer, because if not, and you decide to go and treat or do something else, you're just going to be putting pesticides in the environment that don't have to be there. And it's probably not going to solve your problem because that wasn't your problem. So once we decide it is shothole borer, we go to the third step, which is monitoring for shothole borer. In general, the recommendation or what has been working is having a mixture of both trapping and visual inspections. So the trapping is something more general to have an idea of the population size of the beetles in that area. You can use it to delimit where the which areas are infested and which areas are not infested. Or also, if you have traps around the property, you can use them to guide you where to go and focus your efforts of visual inspections, which take time. So it's good to know where there's a hot spot that you should take more attention to. And so, but once, if we want to assess a tree, we definitely need to do a visual inspection. We're going to be looking for active entry holes on the branches and the trunk. And the way we decide the level of infestation of a tree, as of now, these are the levels that we have set up. So it's considered low infestation with less than 50 entry holes, moderate between 50 and 150, heavy if it has more than 150, and severe when it has more than 150. And also we are observing dieback that is associated with the shothole borer attacks. That could be a little bit tricky sometimes because the tree might have dieback because of other conditions. And that's why a thorough, assessment of the whole tree and the tree health in general is very, very important. Now I talked about active holes. And the reason why is because we have found what we call active and what we call inactive holes. So an active hole is a hole that of, so it's an entry hole to a gallery that has a live adult beetle in it. In an inactive hole, you don't have a live adult beetle in it. And we've started to see lately a lot of trees that are showing inactive holes. And that tends to happen when the tree is able to respond and compartmentalize around the attack. And basically the beetle does not survive or does not thrive in it and either leaves or dies. And then the gallery remains, but there's no beetle in it. So to differentiate one from the other, one of the things that you can look for is for active holes is weeping, the presence of frass, and actually this beetle sticking out of the abdomen of the beetle sticking out of the hole. It's a pretty good one because you are actually seeing the beetles. So all of that are good symptoms or signs that you probably have active holes. The inactive holes tend to look like bulgy sometimes. The entry hole is deformed and there's like a callus forming. Sometimes you can still see the staining around, but there's no defined hole. Or very commonly in sycamores, you can see the hole surrounded by this grayish dry tissue, which is the results of the compartmentalization process in the tree. One way to double check on that and confirm if a hole is actually active or not is to paint the hole with a little bit of just water-based paint. And then you wait in usually around a few minutes to a few hours. If there's a beetle inside that gallery, she will reopen the gallery. And you'll see that the hole has been reopened. We don't know exactly why they do that, but always when they're active, they will always reopen the hole. So the reason why I was able to have this sort of way to distinguish between active and inactive holes is because I painted a lot of these inactive holes and none of them got reopened, which is a good sign. So moving on, when we have to establish the guidelines for our management actions, we have to consider these factors. We have to consider the host species. So this beetle can colonize many trees and reproduce in them, but there's also a lot of hosts where the beetles tries to attack them, but is not able to establish a gallery and establish a fungus colony. So those are a non-reproductive host. So is a tree that gets attacked, but the beetles do not reproduce in it. And the management action for those are very different because really, as long as you get rid of the source of the beetles, that tree is not going to get attacked anymore. So you probably don't need to manage that tree. You need to manage the ones that are reproductive hosts. Then the infestation level makes a big difference what kind of management you're going to do. The host value, if it's a big tree or a small tree, like the size and health of the tree in general, or if it has some cultural value. And that changes, that depends on the land manager. Really is different if you are managing a park and you have thousands of trees and you have to decide over one tree versus if you have your backyard would have three trees and you have to decide over one tree. Of course, every tree, every host is high value when you have three trees. And then the hazard level is something important to keep in mind, like, if it has any safety risk for people or property, like the example here, this tree is leaning, is heavily infested in these areas, and that this is where it could just break, basically, and like this limb can fail and fall on the sidewalk or on the street, which can cause an accident. So it's a really high hazard level tree. So based on that, we created this management matrix that is basically giving you guidelines on what to do. This matrix was included in the SISAC report for the Shothole Borer Strategic Initiative. And you can find it there. And I think Randall will put that link over there in the chat. And then it's going to be included in the Shothole Borer Pest Note that will be published very soon. And that you'll be able to find it in our website and in the UCIPM website. So these are kind of general guidelines that should be adapted to each particular location and each tree. So there's not something as one size fits them all. So the solutions should be sort of like the decision should be taken in a case by case basis, right? So for example, with OC Parks, we've been working from a matrix very similar to this, and we had, you know, tweaked it a little bit because we wanted to include another category of infestation level that is very low. So basically the trees that have only a few exit holes. And that is because we've started noticing that the trees that have only a few exit holes, a few attacks, tend to actually be able to respond in compartmentalism and, you know, that it doesn't, the beetles don't proliferate in that tree. They just like, trees are able to overcome the infestation without needing to be treated or anything like that. So, you know, we are able to adapt it to our needs for management. And regarding treating or not trees that are likely infested, I'm actually doing right now formal trial about that, but I do not have the results to share yet. So stay tuned for the next symposium and I might have something more specific to talk about that. Another good tool is this handout that is also available in our website and is basically a decision-making tree that also can help you make the management decision depending on how you answer different questions regarding more or less the same factors that I talked about earlier on. So regarding management options, we have a toolbox full of different management options that we can use them. So for cultural and mechanical management, you know, the ones that we have is the removal of amplifier trees, the removal of infested branches, and then the correct disposal of infested wood to prevent any future infestations or to prevent the spread of this pest. So when a tree is too far gone, is infested, is severely infested, it has a lot of dieback, those trees are usually not able to survive and removal is a good option in that case. But keep in mind that that's reserved only for those trees that are severely infested. But yes, once a tree is in this stage, there's still a hazard. Trees that are severely infested have a lot of mechanical damage in the limbs, and those limbs can fail and fall on people and property. So when we get to the estate, removal is the main option. Plus, they're full of beetles that can go and infest the surrounding trees. But sometimes if your infestation are located mostly on the branches, you can go ahead and remove the infested branches, lower the number of beetles in the area. Remember, so we're like in our path, in our disease triangle, we are removing one of the corners of the triangle. We're just lowering the number of pathogens or the diseases of the beetles in the disease triangle, so the disease cannot happen. So that's very, very helpful. So you can just remove those limbs and keep the tree, right? Which is also, I think it's one of the best management options right now, especially when you're talking about limbs that are pretty heavily infested. You're going to be getting rid of a lot of beetles in one single move. And then, as I said, make sure to dispose the infested material correctly to not spread the beetles. So if you chip the infested material to a diameter of 1 inch or smaller, that kills 99% of the beetles. And those chips, you can use them in the same property as mulch. That's fine. That's good. But if you're going to be moving those chips to a different location to be used for anything, you need to first compost them to make sure you eliminate all the beetles from that green waste. And then if you have logs, you can solarize them or kiln dry them, and then they can be used for firewood. But if you are wondering about solarization, please visit ishb.org to get more tips on how to do it correctly. And then, so for the biological options, I'm not going to adapt too much into that because we have other speakers that are going to talk about that. And so I'm going to go into the options for chemical management. The idea here is I really want you to consider not applying chemicals as the first response, right? Use all the other tools in your toolbox first, and then leave the chemical management as a last resource. Because in some cases, just monitoring and pruning is enough, right? Like with avocado trees, the infestations are always in the branches. You can prune the infested branches, you keep monitoring, and you have the infestation under control. But sometimes you might need to do it. You should not do treatments as preventative treatments. So only consider treating trees that are infested, and there are high value trees that you need to make sure they stay uninfested, or like they become uninfested. But yet then we know that the chemical treatments have their limitations. There is nothing that will give you 100% control, right? So we have trunk sprays. They're gonna kill a lot of the beetles. Are gonna lower the number of beetles in your area, which is very good. Or in that tree, they're gonna lower the number of beetles in those particular trees that you're gonna be treating, but won't kill all of them because there's many of them that will remain inside the tree that might not get exposed to the insecticide. Now, with soil injections and trunk injections, which are systemic, that goes within the tree, right? It gets moved on the vascular system of the tree. But those also don't always work 100%. Sometimes they might not be able to move if there's not enough water availability for the tree to translocate those compounds. Also, if the tree is too heavily infested, the vascular system could be too compromised for it to be able to move anything. So we have to have trees that have a healthy vascular system for systemics to actually work. And then consider that these trunk injections could foster other infestations by other pathogens in the injection sites. So These are examples of secondary infections of this injection site. So you should consider those risks before you decide to go and do a trunk injections, because sometimes you can end up doing a little bit more damage than if you're not treating. If you still decide to go for a trunk injection for a high value tree, make sure that you protect the injection wound with some fungicide like Vasilis subtilis, just to try to prevent the secondary infections from happening. And lastly, I wanted to show this new method that we've been testing. We call it spot injections. So what it means is we take a epidermic needle and a syringe, and we inject directly into the entry hole of the beetle. And we put 0.1 or 0.2 milliliters, which is literally one or two droplets of the pesticide, and we put it inside the galleries directly. So this is super targeted, right? Like you are just directly targeting that hole with that from that gallery and that beetle inside that gallery. But it's very labor intensive. I don't, you know, like if you have a tree with a lot of holes and you're gonna do that for every hole, but it's still an option for some circumstances in that will work for very high value trees in an area where you wanna do very targeted applications. And even once you got to our last resource, which is treating a tree, the decision of what treatment to use would depend on the location of the tree and the health of the tree and you know the circumstances of that tree. So if the tree is next to a river, like a body of water like this one, you cannot do a spray because the pesticide that was sprayed cannot be used next to water because they're detrimental to water organisms. When you have a tree like the one in the right, you know, doing a soil injection in this tree will be really hard because you barely have any soil to work with around it, and it's like surrounded by a parking lot. So in this case, maybe spraying might end up being your only option, or you could maybe do a trunk injection, maybe. I don't know if you're going to get enough uptake. So there's always these hard decisions to make, and those decisions have to be made case by case, tree by tree. And the first option that you have to, the first thing you think you have to think is, can I use any of the other tools? Can I prune that infested branch? Can I change something in the way, in the cultural practices for this tree to make it more resilient and help it combat the pest by itself? And if not, then if you must, then you go into deciding which kind of pesticide application you will be using. So to wrap it up, in conclusion, we know shothole borer is here to stay, sadly, but there is no need for panic, just like Hannah said. It is manageable, but with timely action. So don't sit on it. Don't let it go really, really bad before you take any action, right? If you keep monitoring your trees, you can stay on top of it. So educate yourself about this pest and diseases. This is what you can do to take action. Take preventative actions to avoid problems. And always look for science-based management actions, which is following an IPM program. And thank you. And I hope I didn't go way beyond the time.
You did not, but we are still a little bit behind. So I think there's one or two questions that have not been answered in the Q&A. So if you could take a moment to do that, I'd appreciate it. And we're going to go ahead and move on to our next speakers. We have Dr. Shannon Lynch, Assistant Professor of Forest Pathology, Department of Environmental Biology with the State University of New York College of Environmental Science and Forestry, and Dr. Keith Eskelin, plant pathologist, UC Cooperative Extension Specialist at University of California, Davis. So I'll turn it over to Shannon.
Thank you, Randall, for that introduction. And hi, everyone. Thanks for having me and Akif. And I'll just get right into it and talk about emerging and really ongoing. It's actually ongoing research. This has been in the development since we discovered shothole borer back in 2012. And I'm going to talk to you today about two different aspects of biocontrol that are being worked on to control the fungus Fusarium that's being carried by the shothole borer, as well as some of the risk assessments that we have been doing, the risk modeling and how we've developed it and applied it and where we're taking it. To start, we're going to talk about biocontrol. I'm going to talk to you about how we are working to use locally adapted endophytes as ways to control Fusarium, the pathogen that's being carried by the beetles. And then Akif Eskelin is going to talk with you about classical biocontrol that is in development. And so just to kind of really take a step back, I want to talk about where all this comes from and how we got here. So you can see how it's applied. So what are endophytes? First of all, you know, endophytes are this part of what's the microbiome. We all have microbes, you know, on our bodies. You heard about the microbiome in your gut. It's like when you eat yogurt, you know, you get all of the good probiotics. Plants have a microbiome too. And endophytes are just a component of that microbiome. They are the fungi and the bacteria that are inside the plant tissues. So they can vary in how many there are and what kinds there are. So we kind of like to say some, you know, trees might have had different flavors of yogurt than others, kind of a thing. And so what's interesting is that these endophytes could be affecting the variation in the disease outcomes that we're seeing that are being affected by shothole borer. We do know that endophytes can be indicators for healthy and diseased trees and other species. And in this case with shothole borer, just to give you an example, so this is a park in Orange County where you have these sycamores that are kind of all similar age and genotypes. And some of these with the yellow arrows, they got infested, but when they got infested, they got better. Some got infested and they got worse. And then some trees, like with the white arrows, they never got infested. And this just could be, you know, one reason or explanation could be that they were susceptible, but not yet infested. But because these trees were planted with a similar genetic makeup, we were thinking that another possibility for this is that the endophytic communities, so the different microbes, how they're composed in these non-infested trees might be contributing to whether or not a tree is susceptible or recovering or even preventing infection in trees. And so to understand how the microbiome or the endophytic microbiome could be actually leveraged for control, which is what we're working on now, we first had to take a step back to see what the endophytic communities look like and what their role is for the different kinds of microbes that we find. And so we were wanting to understand, do the communities actually even differ between diseased and non-diseased trees? And so these are just some petri plates here where we actually took wood sawdust from these different hosts and we sprinkled them onto agar media. And you can see that there are a bunch of different colonies of different kinds of fungi. And in this case, some of them have like lots of the same species. Some of them have only, you know, a couple of colonies of just one species. So there's a lot of variation. And we wanted to see if there was some kind of a signal that we could detect there between the disease and non-disease trees. So there's two important ways to do that. There, and we've used culture-based approaches where we've taken the plant tissues and we put them into petri plates to see what grows. There's also molecular techniques where we use this kind of high throughput approaches of sequencing of DNA from samples to identify members of the community. And we use both approaches, but most of the stuff that I'm going to be talking about, because it's mostly applicable to control, is the culture-based. And so we've done a big survey across this large plot network that we've established in 2017. And I'll talk about that later when I talk about the risk map, but we have a plot network where we're monitoring trees for shothole borer within throughout infested as well as non-infested sites. We've sampled over 1,200 trees in a subset of those plots. So we've captured, all of the variation across their geographic range. And we cultured these endophytes from, a subsample of those. Done a lot of work to identify a whole variety of different fungi. This is just not to get into the details here, but just to show we've really captured the diversity of fungi that can occur inside the wood of these tree species. And I should emphasize that the tree species are our native tree species in riparian habitats. So these include sycamore, cottonwood, willow, oak, and alder. And we also identified a wide range of bacterial diversity as well. And we did an analysis of everything that we cultured to see if the endophyte communities among the disease and non-disease trees, to see if there were differences. And we also looked at avocado as well. And so just one thing I want to point out here is basically what this analysis shows is that any of the kind of dots that are closer together are going to be more similar, and anything that's separated are going to be more different. And what we found is within our wildland species, so our salix, our willows, and our sycamores, what we did find were the differences between these non-disease in the black and disease trees. And so those results are really interesting. They raise interesting questions, about what is going on in these trees, but it also raises the possibility that there are some microbes that are actively protecting trees from attack by Fusarium. This is important because the beetle, like you've seen in the previous talks, is only feeding on the fungus. It's not feeding on the wood. So if we can control the fungus, then we can control potentially the beetle from being able to establish, produce a gallery, and allow it to produce food for the larvae, for the developing larvae inside the galleries. So what we did to test this was we did some screening of all of these fungi and bacteria. And we did these kind of it's called an in vitro assay. So again, we grew them in these petri plates. So this is a plate of just the Fusarium growing on its own. And the picture on the right is a picture of the Fusarium that's growing with these different endophytes. These ones happen to be bacteria. And what these red arrows indicate are these bacteria species that are actually secreting antibiotics through the media, and those antibiotics are preventing the fungus from being able to advance to the edge of the plate. Whereas this particular endophyte here with the blue arrow was not able to prevent the fungus from growing. So again, if these are able to suppress Fusarium growth, then that can potentially have a protective effect on the tree. And there's a lot of different ways that this can happen. These microbes can be secreting antibiotics. They can be out competing the Fusarium in different ways, or they can have no effect at all. And so we've basically done all of the work to characterize how all of these different things are actually behaving and interacting with the Fusarium pathogen itself. And we've taken this a step further and have done some preliminary analysis with avocado seedlings, where we took some of those things that showed inhibition in vitro, and we inoculated those bacteria into the plants and allowed them to establish. And then a few weeks later, after they established, we inoculated them with the Fusarium pathogen and to see if they could colonize on those seedlings where that had those beneficial endophytes. And basically what this graph is showing is the proportion of trees that we re-isolated Fusarium from the seedlings. And basically what this gives us is an indication that when seedlings were co-inoculated with these particular bacterial endophytes and Fusarium, they inhibited the establishment of the pathogen. And again, this is important because the beetles can only survive if they eat the fungus. The fungus itself is a pathogen. And if the microbial communities interfere with that fungal growth, it protects the individual plant and reduces the spread of disease. And so what we're doing with this, and David Pagos is going to talk about this when he talks about kind of all of the projects that SISAC is funding, is we just got our funding awarded to continue this research to test different combinations of those microbes in a broader range of native hosts. So we're going to test them in willow and sycamore, and we're going to inoculate not only just kind of one species of endophytes, but see if we can test different combinations and actually outplant them in the field and see if that establishment of those endophytes persists and if that has an influence on the colonization of Fusarium. And this has important implications. We think the most important applications are for restoration. So if this is something that we can use as a treatment, you know, for things that are going to be outplanted in the field for restoration, if we can find something that can persist and protect these plants, then we have, you know, a potential new tool in our toolbox. We're also kind of looking paired with this is just how these things change over time to see if they interact with the fungus, you know, if those interactions change over time throughout the different seasons as well, because that's going to be important to capture too. And I'm going to just pass the torch over to Akif now, and he's going to talk about biocontrol.
All right. Thank you very much, Shannon. Let's go through these slides. Hi, everyone. I'm just going to give you an update about what we are doing on the biological control of this project. This is the project led by Dr. Richard Stadthammer, who just retired, and Dr. Paul Rockman-Jones from UC Riverside, who is taking the lead on that. So Shannon and I are going to be involved for looking for natural enemies of not only for the beetle. Also, we will be continue screening some of those beneficial endophytes in the native range of these beetles. As Bea mentioned in her talk, IPM program, biological control is part of it. In this part, we are also looking for if there is any natural enemies that could be utilized in these infested areas. So this is the study that has been done by a group of the researchers, and I'm not going to go through all the detail, just give you general information. So when Stadthammer group look into where these beetles are native to, which is, as you can see in this map, this is the most of the Southeast Asian countries. And we also identify that these beetles are not a big problem where they are native to. That also brought us an idea that that could be some natural enemies, could be keeping those populations down, and then therefore we had to look for those. So our first foreign exploration was in Taiwan and Vietnam several years ago. So we were like the group of the researchers went there, looked for the if there's any natural enemies. Next one, please. From that, we collected a lot of infested plant material, mostly on the pruning wounds or part of the plant, and we packed them in that area wherever we collected. We shipped them to the quarantine facility at University of California, Riverside at that time, under the supervision of the Dr. Richard Stadthammer and Paul Rockman Jones. And we wanted to see if there is any natural enemies present on those infested woods with the beetle. From those studies, as you can see, we have just put them in the bucket to see if anything is going to come out. Based on the research, our colleagues at UC Riverside identified three different wasps and three different species from those infested plants. So one of them, the issue was we can rear these wasps on the beetle in quarantine facility to get the offsprings going on. And from those research, that they were able to the brood to one of the species, which is the Pymasticus species, was able to parasitize artificially introduce a beetle in the quarantine facility. So that give us some kind of like the positive light that these beneficials or biocontrol agents could be utilized potentially. So in the history, in the past, these kind of parasitoids has been used on coffee berry borer successfully, and that they have been used that. So this is the idea where that come from. So as I mentioned to you that there are other Southeast Asian countries that we haven't been, and now with the funding extension that Shannon mentioned that, so we will have opportunity to go those countries and then look for any other or more natural enemies of these beetles.
Just to kind of just to reiterate, so this will these new explorations that we'll be doing will be led by Dr. Paul Rockman Jones from at UC Riverside, and we'll be joining him on those explorations as well. I'm just going to kind of wrap this up to talk about the risk map that we develop. And first, I'm going to give you a background on how the model was developed. I'll try to breeze through that and to see where that comes from and how we are applying it and where it is going. As you know, the pest pathogen complex has a very broad host range. This is just kind of like a smattering of the different hosts that we see and how they're affected differently. But the evolutionary relationships among these host species can actually help us a lot about how we can understand where the beetle is actually going to go and cause the most damage, because more closely related hosts are actually more severely affected than less closely related hosts. And this was something that I documented and published in my own research. And because Fusarium dieback hosts are distributed over a complex landscape, where, you know, some sites will have one species like an avocado grove and others have a lot of different species like these natural forests, we wanted to use this evolutionary understanding of host relationships to predict which locations of beetle and pathogen is most likely to establish and cause damage in California. And so to do this, we established, like I introduced earlier, a large plot network in infested and non-infested locations throughout peri-urban and wildland forests throughout California, as well as avocado groves, to basically incorporate the whole environmental range of conditions over which the beetle and fungus are able to thrive. We collected microclimate data in each of these plots, and we measured the amount of disease if present within each tree species. And all of this was done through amazing efforts and lots of rattlesnake encounters as well by my field crews. So we had a good time. And so to basically build the model, we estimated site susceptibility based on a couple of things. We did it based on host evolutionary relationships. So this is just like a cartoon of a tree, just showing the relationships among different tree species. So we used that information and we weighted it by how abundant they were within each plot. And then we also incorporated microclimate into the model because we know from previous work that beetles produce more generations per year with warmer climate. So we used a degree day model with our microclimate data to estimate the number of beetle generations in each plot. And we incorporated that into the model. And basically what we found was that the host relationships are actually primary to being able to predict where the beetle is most likely to go. But there was this interesting kind of interaction where sites that were otherwise unsusceptible, so the host relationships didn't really have kind of, they were otherwise unsusceptible based on just their host composition. In those locations, warmer conditions that could produce more beetle generations were actually became more susceptible. So microclimate kind of mediated the importance. And so basically, we took that model that we developed based on this large plot network, based on 15,000 trees that we surveyed and 260 plots, and we applied it statewide. And we did that in a couple of different ways. So thanks to Dr. Natalie Love from Cal Poly, she compiled tree inventory data, street tree inventory data from 170 cities. So these were complete street tree inventories from these huge amount of grids across the state. And we were able to use the tree composition and apply the model to those at those area in those areas where we had those tree inventory data. And then this is kind of what it looks like. And what you can see is just the distribution. You can see we don't have a complete inventory of the entire state of California, but we have these clusters of spots where we can at least say, if we look at it here in, if we zoom into Orange County in these 1 kilometer grids, these locations that have these red grids are going to be more susceptible. And the locations with the yellow grids or the light yellow grids are going to be less susceptible. And so in these areas outside of the infested range, we can at least say something to the effect that, okay, these are sites that represent a location where if human-mediated movement of plant material, for example, were to introduce the beetle into these locations, these could be a center for which the beetle could actually establish, and it could establish there, and then those could be a center from which the beetle could actually spread. So it at least gives us an indication and shows us that we can actually apply the model if you have complete inventories in your particular site. And because we have microclimate data that is more widely available across the state, we worked with Alan Hollander to basically get these layers of microclimate data so that we can actually use the degree day model to fill in all of those gaps. And so you can kind of use these things in conjunction with one another. And so basically, this is kind of what the risk map looks like, where you have these clusters where we have tree inventory data, and then you have these locations where, based on the climate information, the darker blue the locations are, the more beetles that can get produced in that location, and the lighter green locations are cooler temperatures that produce less beetle generations. And these panels on the left are kind of locations that I picked out that are within the infested range, just so you can see for comparisons. And then these are locations on the right panel that are in the non-infested range. So these are kind of more in Northern California. So this is Sacramento up here with the D, and this is in the Bay Area in the middle. And here is Palm Springs. And so the idea is that you can kind of use both this combination of climate and host to identify which locations are probably going to be more susceptible, keeping in mind that the host information is the most important. So basically, just to kind of wrap this up, the continuing research that we're doing to kind of expand this work with the support from CISAC funding is basically we're using the long-term plot monitoring and the predictive modeling. We're going to expand this. We're going to be going out this year to revisit actually all of those plots to get a fifth year of data so that we can actually do the modeling of spread over time. So all of this modeling so far is just a snapshot in time. So we want to be able to make predictions over time and using that time information to better predict spread across California. And also, this model is being used and applied to do statewide bioeconomic modeling as well. And that is being supported by CISAC as well. And this is part of a larger team that's being led by Dr. Karen Jetter from UC Davis. So I think I am happy to kind of answer questions because I don't want to go too far much further over time. So I'm happy to answer questions in the Q&A or later in the discussion. And I just want to thank everybody.
Thank you, Shannon and Akif. Yes, you're right. Still behind, but there are questions in the Q&A. If you could go in there and answer those, we'd appreciate it. And then we will go on to our next speaker, who is David Pagos, Special Assistant Plant Division from the California Department of Food and Agriculture.
Okay, excellent. My name is David Pagos, and thank you very much for having me today. I'm going to talk a little bit about the Invasive Species Council of California and related California Invasive Species Advisory Committee, as well as go over some of the funding mechanism that we have that you've heard a lot of today, actually. So again, my name's David. I work with the California Department of Food and Agriculture as a special assistant. For example, I do invasive species projects for Japanese beetle in Sacramento County's ongoing treatment that's happening right now in Sacramento County. I'm also the Invasive Species Council of California Executive Director, as well as the advisory committee. I also work with Jonathan Babineau, who's another staff member that works with us on the Invasive Species Council of California. The big picture is there's a lot of agencies working on invasive species kind of in their own silos. So the goal is really to try to collaborate and communicate amongst those. I like this diagram here. You'll see that the council, made up of six secretaries, which I'll go over here in a moment, has the advisory committee reporting to the council, and then working groups can report to the advisory committee as well. So the a lot of opportunity for feedback and input into the invasive species system. So just some quick bylaws. The council members are the secretaries of the following state agencies. So California Department of Food and Agriculture and California Natural Resources Agencies are co-chairs. The Environmental Protection Agency, California State Transportation Agency, Health and Human Services, and the Governor's Office of Emergency Services are also all members of the council. So those are the six secretaries that make up the Invasive Species Council of California. The goal is to have a coordinated approach to invasive species. Invasive Species Council represents the highest level of leadership and authority in state government regarding invasive species. And you just have a picture here of some of the invasive species du jour that we're trying to keep out here. For example, the Asian longhorn beetle, kudzu, the weed that ate the South, the giant African land snail, and the northern pike are just some examples of invasive species. The council's purpose is to coordinate a comprehensive effort to first and foremost exclude or prevent invasive species from coming to California. And then if they get here, to eliminate, reduce, or mitigate those impacts here in California. And the idea is to address non-native organisms which cause economic or environmental harm. The duties of the council agencies are to identify actions involving invasive species and then to use their program and authority to, again, prevent the introduction of invasive species, detect and respond, monitor the invasive species population, restore invaded ecosystems, conduct research, and then promote all promoted through public education. And some of the commitments are to develop what we call a living list of invasive species that have a reasonable likelihood of entering California, and then to produce a strategic framework with goals, objectives, and matrix for state agencies acting on invasive species and review protocols and authorities, recommend any changes in law. And again, this is all developed through a public process. So the California Invasive Species Advisory Committee is made up of a diverse group of 19 individuals, some of which you've heard from today. Bay and Shannon are both members as well. They have a broad range of background and experience. And then we can convene additional working groups or subgroups so that we can have as many individuals as possible participating in this discussion. So the nomination process for the advisory committee is one letter of interest, two letters of support. And this is the makeup of the advisory committee currently. Four of the members are designated by the co-chair. So CDFA secretary and resources agency secretary. So think of Secretary Crowfoot and Secretary Ross made four appointments, and then the EPA secretaries, transportation secretary, health and human services, the executive director or the director of the emergency services, and then also the California Agricultural Commissioners and Sealers Association, and then there's six open positions in the committee as well. So that's just a brief overview of the advisory committee and the Invasive Species Council of California. And so they're through a number of different efforts, and I want to acknowledge Dr. Kabashima, who's on here, who is instrumental in a lot of this efforts that you're hearing of today. We were able to receive two pots of $5 million for invasive shothole borer. One of them went to CDFA, and we conducted research and trapping. The money actually went to the advisory committee, and then we did research, trapping, pathways, outreach, administration. And I'll talk about tree removal here in a moment. Some of the research projects that you've heard of are the integrated pest management work, epidemiology, did a study on chipping, endophytes, and economic impacts. Additionally, there's biological foreign exploration, but due to COVID, that project wasn't able to be completed, as well as a couple others. So there was some remaining funds that were approximately $1.1 million for research, and that's what you heard of today from Shannon on the epidemiology, endophytes, and the agricultural crop work. We're also expanding the economic impacts, and then you also heard about the biological foreign exploration that would be taking place. Additionally, with the first pot of $5 million, we did trapping, statewide trapping, as well as Hannah, who you heard from earlier, is funded through this mechanism. Then we're also still analyzing the green waste pathway, trying to find a mitigation step or a kill step in the process that could potentially eliminate or at least slow the spread of invasive shothole borers through green waste. And then, of course, outreach is always important. We work on firewood is one pathway that is a concern. But then there's also other pathways, as we already talked about, green waste. So Randall Oliver is one of those that helps us with the outreach. And then administration, the UCIPM program, helped us oversee this, the grants on the research and the outreach and trapping. And then the legislature also was able to give $5 million to CAL FIRE, and that 4.5 was used for tree removal funds in the leading edge counties and down south, main, all of it was. And of that, $500,000 was used for trapping supplies. So it was really great partnership on the work. And I think you've all heard a lot of the great research that's happened from this initial investment. So additionally, there was $5 million more that was sent to the Invasive Species Council of California. There's a lot of numbers here, and I wasn't sophisticated enough to be able to highlight the things that I wanted to highlight here was the Invasive Species Tours and Summit. So for those participants on the call, we will be holding a summit next year. And leading up to that summit, we hope to hold some invasive species tours in Northern, Central, and Southern California. And so we solicit folks on this webinar to help us with that tours and to get the word out. Additionally, the other item I wanted to point out here was invasive species shothole borer line item there for 1.5 plus million. That's to target the Polyphagus shothole borer, the Crotrima shothole borer, as well as the more recently detected Mediterranean oak borer in the Napa, Sonoma, Sacramento County region to try to limit that, as well as some other projects with regards to invasive shothole borers. So those are really the kind of highlight. Just wanted to touch on the council, the two pots of money that we received, and I know we're running out of time, so I will skip any questions. Mr. Oliver, so how would you like to proceed?
Thank you, David. And we'll go ahead and move quickly on to our next speaker, Henry Herrera. He's a forester with Cal Fire.
Good afternoon, everybody. And thank you for being with us this afternoon. Cal Fire's Urban Community Forestry Grant Program is what I'm going to be talking about today. The grant program provides funding to local government agencies, special districts, and nonprofit organizations. Projects are required to take place in urban areas, and we usually have a requirement of at least 75% of our grant funds having to be spent in disadvantaged communities, defined by the Cal EnviroScreen 4.0 tool. Okay, so these are the five main project types that we fund. The most common one is our tree planting grant program to plant trees in urban areas, and associated costs with planting that covers materials, supplies, bioswales, removal of concrete, and post-grant maintenance. The other type of grant activity that we fund is urban forest management activities, such as tree inventories, urban forest management plans, urban forest mapping and analysis, urban forest policy development or improvement. We also fund urban forestry education and workforce development projects. These are projects where participants are trained and educated in urban forestry and arboriculture, and the grantees partner with potential employers that will potentially employ the participants that took part in that project, that grant. The other type of activity that we fund is urban wood biomass utilization. Rather than having trees removed and taken to the landfill, we want to utilize that wood to preserve the carbon and provide other benefits. And this year, for the first time, we are funding green schoolyard projects, the removal of asphalt and concrete on school campuses for the purpose of planting trees on school campuses. So our Urban Community Forestry Grant Program is not necessarily aimed at insect or disease control. However, we do understand that in order to plant trees, sometimes there's a need to remove trees. And so if you have a project that requires tree removal and the trees are dying due to a natural disaster, such as an insect pest outbreak or perhaps an area was burned, maybe due to drought or wind damage, we will consider funding part of that or potentially all of that to remove trees in order to plant trees in urban areas. We do have a 25% match requirement, and so the grantee could also incur the cost of the tree removal and use that as a match in order to remove trees and receive funds from us to plant trees in urban areas. I'm going to give an example of a project that we did. This was a grant that was awarded in 2016 to the nonprofit organization Amigos de los Rios, and it was at the Whittier Narrows Recreation Area, which was ground zero for the prolific shothole borer outbreak. And this project covered an area of approximately 1,500 acres of this recreation area. And it was in collaboration with the LA County Department of Parks and Recreation, UCANR, BN, and Dr. John Kabashima have both been involved in this project. The Los Angeles Conservation Corps, Long Beach Conservation Corps, and the Conservation Corps of California, Pomona, all took part in this project. It was for about $500,000, with the grantee matching, providing $170,000 in match. And the project removed heavily infested trees in this recreation area, and they planted 600 trees. It also included some concrete removal and the planting of trees in some parking lots. The grantee partnered with Angel City Lumber near downtown LA, and they used some of the wood from the trees that was removed to create benches to bring back to the park. The grantee also created a tree inventory, a database of the trees in the recreation area, assessing their health status, their species, the location of the trees, along with some additional information. The project included community outreach and volunteer events, training of the participants in insects and diseases, tree identification, planting, and it also funded some fellows from Amigos de los Rios. We are now talking about another program to continue these efforts at the Whittier Narrows Recreation Area. Here are some pictures of the benches that were created. On the top left, you can see one of the benches, and then on the top right, you see some of the trees that were planted, as well as the bottom, some more trees and another bench there on the bottom right. We currently don't have funding for this kind of work. The funds for this year were pulled back. We do have $117 million for schoolyard greening, and that application period is currently open through April 28th. Yesterday, we were notified that CAL FIRE will receive $43 million from the Forest Service from Inflation Reduction Act funds. And once we receive that money, we do plan to make that money available for grants to implement the urban and community forestry project types that I discussed today. And on top of that, the Forest Service currently does have their application period to award grants directly to eligible entities using Inflation Reduction Act funds for urban and community forestry projects. Here are some additional resources if you'd like to learn more about our grant program. Here's my contact information, phone and email towards the bottom. Please feel free to reach out to me. I am the CAL FIRE Regional Urban Forester in LA and Ventura Counties, so I'd be happy to provide you with more information if you're interested. Thank you.
Thanks, Henry. We greatly appreciate it. And as I'll be mentioning a little bit later toward the end of our presentation, this presentation fits in exactly with what we're doing tomorrow with our field event, where we're going to be out at Bosque del Rio Hondo Park, which is at the southeastern end of Whittier Narrows, to do some actual looking at this stuff in the field. But with that, let's go on to our case studies, starting with a tribal land experience. And for that, we have Marissa Hernandez, who's environmental technician with the Santa Ynez Chumash Environmental Office. Marissa?
Yeah, so like Randall said, I'm with the Santa Ynez Chumash Environmental Office as an environmental technician, just to talk about a little bit of what we've been doing in regards to ISHB. Just a little background on the Chumash community. Our office is located on the reservation, and the reservation has about 100 households. And in this map right here, the red outline is showing you the border of the reservation, and the blue line is actually a creek. So all of the houses are located around the creek, so it's a pretty heavily riparian habitat. So a lot of the tree species that we see are the box elder, willow, and we also have a lot of coast live oak. And in terms of monitoring, so we actually are in partnership with Santa Barbara County, and they come out and help us do surveys and trapping for IDing the ISHB. And this has been going on for about a year and a half now. It's been going on for a year and a half, but we actually only first detected it on the reservation in July of 2022, so this past summer. That process pretty much just looks like a representative from the county comes out once a month to help us replace the traps. They're just the sticky traps with the pheromones. And then she goes back and collects that data, sees if there's any signs of the beetle on the traps, and then they also do visual surveys where they come out and look at the trees and identify any infected ones. And that takes place once a month. And then here's just some pictures of other things that we've been doing. So this right here is our intern, Sachi, who went out and helped us ID and flag some of the infested trees that we were finding. A lot of them were willow trees, although we do have a lot of box elders on the reservation, but they didn't seem to go for those ones. They were really targeting our willows. And we did this flagging all throughout the creek. We took a day and just walked like the whole thing and flagged any infested trees that we found, just so that they were ready to be thoroughly examined when the representative from the county came out, so that they can tell us if it's treatable or if it needs to be completely removed. And then right here is just a small chart of some of the data that she's found. So on the traps themselves, the highest number of beetles has actually only been 23, which is a cause for concern. But when we went out and did a visual surveys of the trees, there were not enough boring holes to warrant removal, because I believe the number is 150 and we didn't quite reach that, but we were still monitoring the trees to keep an eye on them so that they didn't get worse. So right now on the reservation, we have about 5 sticky traps set up, and we just set up a 6th one closer to the creek just to ensure that we were getting all of the data that we needed. That trap was just set up at the beginning of the year, so we haven't received any data on that one yet. And then here's just some examples of the trees that we have been seeing. As you can see, some of them are pretty heavily infested, and then some of them have only a few signs of the borer. Yeah, so all of these trees are just willows. And then some management efforts that we've been doing. We've collaborated with the Chumash Fire Department on clearing the creek, because that's where we've been seeing a lot of the infested trees. And the creek is just overgrown in general. So a lot of those are just like overgrown trees and downed that have been there for years, but are still a good host for the beetles. So we collaborated with them to clear some of those out. And we went out and actually ID'd the ones that we preferred to them to cut down before they started any of that. And then we also made sure that all of the downed trees were chipped. And we don't have any chemical treatment process right now. One of the possible challenges are that residents might be concerned with any pesticides being sprayed because the trees are so close to houses. And a lot of the trees are also right along the creek, like I said. So there's concerns of insecticides being located in the watershed. And we have been doing some education and outreach as much as possible just to get people to not move wood. So we put out these flyers in our monthly and quarterly newsletters just to get that word around, really just educating people about what ISHB are and to make sure to not move wood is what we've been really emphasizing to people. That's all I have for you guys today.
Thank you, Marissa. And just to keep things moving, we'll go on to our next speaker. This is Tim Hunt, Tree and Hardscape Supervisor with the City of Lakewood, talking about their experiences And Tim has told me his camera is not working well. So you'll have a blank screen, unfortunately. But Tim, you want to tell us about what the experience has been in your city?
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for the invite, Randall. We really appreciate it. I'm Tim, the Trees and Hardscape Supervisor for the City of Lakewood. I just want to give a slight background about, you know, us as a city and then kind of our experience that we have with ISHB. We're in South LA County. We're just about 23 miles south of Los Angeles. Our city's 9.5 square miles, not too big, but not too small. Residential population is about 80,000. We have 150 miles of street, about 300 miles of sidewalk, and our street tree inventory with our parks included is just under 25,000 at the moment. We have about 150 acres of parks, 8 fully staffed, and we have 3 nature trails, which was our initial discovery of ISHB was on our phase 1 of our nature trails, which is the longest one at about 3/4 of a mile. All our nature trails are based on California native species. They're modeled after riparian woodlands. We include kind of a dry creek bed, large grassy areas, all native species. Our phase 1 was where we initially discovered it. And I believe it was 2018. my responsibility in that aspect is running our department. Our department's fairly small. We have 4 full-time employees, 2 part-time employees, but we also look to West Coast arborists for a majority of our large-scale trimming and pruning. So when we first kind of discovered the invasion of ISHB was on our West San Gabriel Nature Trail, was in some of our really large cottonwoods. We kind of noticed a large die-off, continual breakage of limbs. We had quite a few limbs down, and upon inspection, we noticed kind of major bleeding areas, just the basic issues associated with ISHB. So after we kind of noticed that, we did our own research, kind of discovered what we're looking at, the kind of the issue, and contacted the County of Los Angeles, where we instituted the help of Rachel Burnap, which was an extremely helpful on our side with her knowledge and basis of what she knows about the ISHB. We were able to go out there and trap successfully with Rachel. She sent those off for a positive identification. I believe we came back with a polyphagus. Upon that, you know, looking at that and discussing with her, the areas that were infected were extremely bad. So we instituted a removal plan. We sent it out to bid for multiple contractors. We ended up coming back with one, and we were able to get grant money to fund that. So I think in the end, we removed about 14 trees, all of which were 45, 50 plus years old. They were probably on the trail before we instituted the nature trail. So that was kind of an experience in ourselves, as some of our older trees were the most affected. Again, some of our smaller sycamore trees that are in the area do show signs of infestation, but we ourselves have been able to kind of sustain that infestation by selectively pruning, removing limbs that are dead. And we've seen more control in that aspect along that nature trail. We're not seeing as many amplifier trees at the moment because of the elimination of the cottonwoods that we did originally. We do have a small spread. The spread's mostly contained to areas next to our nature trail. We have sawtooth zelkovas, which we've discovered are very susceptible to ISHB in our area and are very showing extreme signs of dieback. So again, would be our next area of concentration on that. Once we identified that, we had the company that we instituted a solar burn off. So we located an area that was next to our freeway, which is a large open area, and we had the chip and brush all dumped there, and it was all covered. We continue to monitor that. As of right now, we haven't seen any spread along that area where the chip has been dumped, so we consider that successful on our end. A big point to us was, you know, early identification of it. I think we ended up catching it at its high point in that aspect, because some of the trees that we did deal with, some of the cottonwoods, were completely dead at the moment of removal. So again, early identification is going to be a big part moving forward to control the spread. Luckily, we haven't experienced too much of the spread throughout the rest of the city. Reinerson Park, adjacent to West San Gabriel Nature Trail, has shown signs in some of our California sycamores, which again, aren't too bad. We were able to kind of contain that by selective pruning and removal of some of the highly affected species. But again, it's going to be a constant work in progress on our part. We've yet to institute any sort of spraying or trunk injections, which is something I have discussed with our local area manager from West Coast. It's very possible that we institute that in the coming years if we see a higher infestation rate rather than what we're experiencing now. As far as right now, our next area of concentration will be our sawleaf alcovas along our residential area. So again, try to keep it short and concise. I think I wrote maybe a little bit too much for my time sleet allotted. I have a couple other things to attend to today, but again, Randall, I really appreciate you letting me come by and share our experience.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it. Great to hear about how you've addressed this issue there. Now we're going to move into a separate group of case studies, basically looking at restoration in the urban forest. What do you do after you've had this problem with the shothole borers? And our first speaker on that is going to be talking about UC Irvine shothole borer management and reforestation. This is Matt Dines, principal planner for campus planning and sustainability.
Thanks, Randall. So I won't, as Randall mentioned, I won't focus too much on our response as far as spraying and treatment on the campus. Instead, I'll focus more on the reforestation efforts. But if you haven't been to our campus before, it's situated near Newport in the city of Irvine. You can see we're really close to the ocean. And we have a large campus. It's approximately 1,500 acres in size, with a residential community of both students and faculty around 16,000. And a daytime population of 40,000 people coming and going to our campus. And we're a growing campus. We continue to expand our academic enterprise and student housing. So we currently have close to 15 million square feet of building space. But we are lucky in that we do have close to a third of our campus is open space. So we have an ecological preserve, which is around 60 acres, and then adjacent to our campus is the UC San Joaquin Marsh Reserve, which is part of the natural reserve system. As far as our shothole borer infestation, we learned of it in late 2014. And as you can see by this diagram, it was pretty pervasive throughout our campus. The red dots are indicating just the trees that have some level of infestation. We did have a significant concentration of beetle and fungus complex within our campus core. So around Aldrich Park and especially our Ring Mall. And, you know, after this survey, we realized that we had over 2,000 trees that had been attacked. So very significant. And so we were faced with a lot of removals. We ended up removing around 800 trees immediately, and many of those were amplifier trees. A lot of them were, you know, sycamore or platanus species that had been on our campus for close to 60 years when the campus was originally developed. But, you know, that was most of the infestation were in those species, but we did find that there were 75 different species in total that were attacked on the campus. And this is just a list of the trees that were in the order of quantity of infestation that were impacted by the shothole borer. These are images in Aldrich Park of, and you can see how heavily infested some of the sycamore trees are on the right. And we started the removal, but we also looked at this as, you know, an opportunity for us to work with, you know, UC scientists and researchers, you know, to use the campus as a field site for them to do their research. So Akif Eskelin and John Kavashima, Akif is in the lower left picture, taking a look at sections from a recent removal of a heavily infested tree. But we worked with them and they did studies, you know, on a variety of different treatments and combination of treatments. So as I mentioned, we did remove close to 800 trees. And so we were faced with a significant reforestation effort in our main campus. But we had some big steps that we needed to take that really hadn't been taken by many entities. And that was really, okay, what are we going to replant with? And so this was a big effort on our part. We collaborated with Spurlock Landscape Architects and other researchers and other groups that had already started to have this issue with the infestation to develop a tree palette of species that were showing some sort of resistance to the complex. And we did this really by just looking, you know, having our observations on which species, especially those that are adjacent to amplifier trees, are, you know, showing resistance. And so that was our first step. So once we developed that tree palette, we wanted to re-strategize how we planted the campus. You know, over time, the campus had been used to a design which was, you know, street tree themed and monoculturistic. So in our ring mall, we had one species, the London plane tree, as well as some sycamore species. So it was one monoculture throughout. And then we also have that same, you know, street tree theme or monoculture throughout our streets. And so we really wanted to make sure that not only were we increasing the diversity of our replanting and making sure, you know, by doing that, we were finding, you know, thinking that we would be more resistant to, you know, heavy impacts or heavy losses if there was any other infestation in the future. And so we wanted to increase the diversity, and we also wanted to get away from that street tree themed planting style and move towards a more naturalistic planting style. And so we also, in areas where we did have space, we wanted to hedge our bets a little bit by, if we had room for another tree species behind one, we wanted to provide that kind of redundancy where we had space to replant. And then we looked at, as far as phasing, how are we going to do this? We worked with Spurlock Landscape Architects on a planting plan that really addressed the heavily impacted areas, which were within our gateway quad, which is our campus entry. And so you can see in dark blue, that area was replanted first, along with about half of our ring mall in dark blue as well. So those were the first areas that we reforested, and we used larger trees to have a more immediate impact in those areas. As many of you know, a university, the urban forest provides, you know, huge value to the campus. And so prioritizing those heavily impacted areas was important to us. And then we had subsequent phases to finish replanting the ring mall. And then a third phase where we really focused on reforesting and adding diversity within Aldrich Park. And these are the species that we use primarily throughout the reforestation. Along the ring mall, you know, we did use a street tree theme, but instead of doing the entire circle in one species, we divided up by quads. So there ended up being a similar kind of feel to a street tree planting, but it wasn't the entire length of the ring mall. And then I went out a couple of days ago just to take pictures of where we're at. So You can see the replanting effort along the ring mall on the far left with elm trees that are planted along the ring mall. And this was an area where we felt like we could add trees in the background. It's difficult to see, but we did plant jacarandas between that and our library. And so you can see in 2023, the elms are looking good and the jacarandas are just starting to bloom. With that, I will pass it along to you, Randall.
Thank you, Matt. Appreciate it very much. And to keep things moving, we'll go ahead and move on to our next speaker, who's talking about restoration of Big Canyon. The restoration efforts there actually began for other reasons before they discovered the shothole borer, and then that I think compounded the story. But our speaker on this is Elise Arenas, restoration manager from the Newport Bay Conservancy.
So hi, Elise here with the Newport Bay Conservancy. I help manage restoration programs around the Upper Newport Bay Nature Preserve, I'll say. Thanks for the opportunity to present today. So I am going to give you like a little intro on who we are, the history of the bay, and then we'll dive into some restoration that allowed us to address the shothole borer infestation in a certain area of the bay. So like Randall said, wasn't the main priority, but it was a big priority as part of our restoration. So the Newport Bay Conservancy is an environmental nonprofit, and we have a mission to protect and preserve the Upper Newport Bay. And we do that through restoration, through education, research, and some advocacy. And I will say that we don't do this work alone. Our work is possible due to, for starters, the native people and the original inhabitants and stewards of this territory. Have a connection to these waters and lands, as well as CDFW, OC Parks, and the city of Newport Beach. And together we protect about 1,000-acre preserve that contains riparian, coastal sage scrub, salt marsh, mudflat, marine habitats, to name a few. All that to say is that we are a biodiversity hotspot. So for those that don't know where we are, I'm going to orient you on this map a little bit here. So we're in Southern California, and for those that aren't familiar with the area, we're about 45 miles south of LA, I'll say, in Newport Beach, just down the street from the last presenter's location. So very close to UCI. And so the Upper Newport Bay has had a history of challenges, if you will. History of disturbance, there's surrounding urban development all the way up until the edges of the reserve. We have a history of invasive species. There's multiple landowners. And so a short history lesson here, you can kind of, I'm going to say it because I think it's important to the work you're doing to restore certain areas of the bay. So you can think back in the 18th century when the Spanish missionaries arrived to California, our wetlands along the coast were abundant. And gradually those wetlands have been lost due to development. So you can think what replaced those along the coast are commercial ports, yachts, marinas, and even waterfront housing. So by 75, we say less than 10% of our original coastal wetlands remain between Santa Barbara and the Mexican border. So in the 60s, the Upper Newport Bay here, if you can see my cursor, maybe, was going to be slated for development. And there were local citizens, most notably Frank and Francis Robinson, that fought many years of legal battles to protect this reserve. At the same time, the Friends of Newport Bay, which is now the Newport Bay Conservancy, played a big role in getting public attention to educate the community about the importance of this area and worth protecting it. So all those efforts combined, the Upper Newport Bay became a designated ecological reserve in 75, and then slowly the city and the county added to the reserve in the early 80s and 90s, and now we have what we call the Upper Newport Bay Nature Preserve. So a little history, and I'm going to take some time to walk you through our Big Canyon restoration project, which I highlighted here in red or in the red box, which does include some management of shothole borer. Big Canyon. So Big Canyon is a relatively small section of the bay compared to the 1,000 acres. We're looking at 60 acres of the Big Canyon Nature Park, as we call it. It's tucked away
in between a major road, Jamboree, just north of San Joaquin Road, and then Back Bay Drive, our one-way scenic route through the bay, is on this end right here, Back Bay Drive. And so the entire restoration project consists of three phases, and it is about 35 acres of active restoration. So this area has been heavily influenced by the construction of salt, like a salt evaporation pond that was created. We've placed historical dredge material or fill from the estuary into the canyon, and stockpiling this dredge material that was done in the 50s or 60s, and that has raised the elevations in our Big Canyon area project site. And so it has created kind of a mess, I'll say, to say lightly. And so if you look at phase one, which is over here closer to Jamboree, this area was completed, or the construction or restoration was completed in 2017 by the City of Newport Beach. And together with the Irvine Ranch Conservancy, they have maintained and monitored that area for the last 5-6 years now. And this phase consisted of some creek and riparian restoration. They constructed a stormwater treatment bioretention cell. They created some wetlands, diverted selenium impacted dry weather flows, and then they did improve some culverts and trails around this area. So this project started mostly for water quality reason. Shothole borer was addressed in this area as well through a selective removal process. And that process was adopted in phase two and will be adopted in phase three. So phase two is about 11 acres. So phase one was about 9 acres. Phase two in the yellow dotted line here, I will talk to in more detail. And then briefly, phase three is the bottom lower half of the canyon, which we're currently in the planning, permitting, and design process for that. And this is a special opportunity to create 14 acres of wetland habitat. And I'll keep it that simple. we will move to phase two. So before we get any farther, I will take a moment to acknowledge the folks that make this work possible. So that includes our dedicated restoration team, all our volunteers, they are wonderful, and our board, and also huge thanks to our very active partners and our funders, the City of Newport Beach, CDFW, the Fish and Wildlife Service, Ocean Protection Council, State Coastal Conservancy. Without them, this project would not be financially possible. So major site issues. We had altered hydrology and dry weather flows. So history of that dredge material being dumped in this site caused the elevation to increase. And then it also caused the channel to shift a little bit to the north. We're in a highly urbanized area. We have year-round dry weather flows, which can be very helpful for plant establishment, since there's water on the site. But it's also responsible for why we have such a high level of selenium in this local watershed. The area was dominated by Brazilian pepper trees. Stagnant water that allowed for mosquito breeding habitat is obviously an issue. There were lots of non-native mature vegetation that was potential fire fuel hazard. And then illegal activities, undesired activities that happened there. And then most notably the invasive shothole borer infestation, or the reason we're here today. So the goals of the restoration were to remove all of non-native invasive plants and remove any infested vegetation that was infested with shothole borer, native or non-native. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit. We wanted to restore the hydrology. So we wanted to reduce erosion in the channel. We also wanted to reconnect the channel to the floodplain. And then we wanted no stagnant water. So water should keep moving to avoid pooling, to avoid mosquito habitat. And then the last thing we wanted to do was bring in native plant communities. So the list of plant communities were to support listed species, reduce fire fuel, and also hopefully be less susceptible to the shothole borers. So phase two, before the restoration, you can kind of see here on the left side, what we call a monoculture of Brazilian pepper trees, very thick canopies. These trees have the ability to change and alter the soil chemistry. They don't allow very much to grow underneath or around, so doesn't really allow for very biodiverse habitat. And then on the right, we've kind of mapped out, again, this is before the restoration happened, what was there. And so I'm just going to bring your attention to the light yellowish color, which is the dominant pepper tree grove. And then these darker green areas around, which we call our, I think they're called like willow pepper tree grove, or royal willow mix and pepper tree grove. But these are what we are referring to as our selective removal areas. And so phase two was completed in 2022. So in the fall of 2022, we restored 11 acres of habitat with the city of Newport Beach. So we removed all the Brazilian pepper trees, all non-native species, and any native infested shothole borer species. And we replaced them with native riparian and alkali meadow or marsh species, as well as upland habitat species. And so we are providing habitat for sensitive species, such as our least bells vireo and some sensitive or endangered and sensitive species. So least bells vireo, yellow warbler, yellow-breasted chat, to name a few. We reconnected the floodplain to the channel. And then currently, in partnership with the city, we are maintaining and monitoring this phase, which does include monitoring and addressing any shothole borer infestation or potential reinfestation. We do know that it occurs elsewhere in the bay and it is found in Big Canyon. So we are mindful of that. So just photos for fun, because who doesn't like photos in a presentation? So before, you can kind of see the outskirts and inside the Brazilian pepper trees. And then here we have some photos kind of documenting or highlighting the shothole borer infestation. So we have the infestation, how the trees were removed. We stockpiled branches, separated leaves and branches and trunks. And then we did chip everything down and solarize it, as it was kind of what we called our special provisions that was related to shothole borers for phase two. And so these practices were adopted to what was done in phase one, and kind of taking lessons learned to what was done in phase one and phase two, we'll implement these processes as well in phase three. So we were required to selectively prune and grub any native and non-native vegetation that was infested with shothole borer. We had to chip it and stockpile it on site. So we did ask the contractors to chip it to less than 1 inch in diameter and in length. And then they were solarized under these tarps on site. And then later they were spread, any of the infested material was spread along the trails in the canyon. So we kept all the material in sight to not spread the infestation or the beetle, but also it is a little cheaper that way. Here are some more photos highlighting our hydro seeding efforts and plantings for the first year. And you can see kind of the growth on the bottom three photos on the right that the vegetation is starting to fill in. More photos highlighting the project site and volunteers. Again, this work is done in partnership. Yes, we have a lot of money for contractors, but we have volunteers out here every single week helping us with reed removal, planting opportunities, and all of that. So here's kind of the final habitat zones that we designated in the site. And so we were able to restore about 11 and a half acres of open space while addressing, you know, the mosquito breeding habitat, fire fuel hazards, providing or addressing erosion and flood control, water quality issues, and the shothole borer infestation. So the four habitat zones here are the riparian corridor in the green. We have some wet and high alkali meadows in the blue and the yellow, and then our buffer zones or CSS in the orange there. And so native habitat, as I said before, was chosen to support listed species. Think our least bells vireo, California gnatcatcher, and some sensitive or listed plants as well. And it is worth noting that this canyon does drain right into an MPA, a marine protected area, so that even more listed species that you can think of. I will briefly say that the monitoring and treating of invasive shothole borer continues in phase one and two. Most recently, I know that the city and IRC have identified infestations in phase one, and they were very quick to respond. where it was either removal of a tree or limbs. And the same will be done in phase two. We have funding to hire contractors to monitor our vegetation that was planted and any old trees that were left behind as part of the selective removal process. I will say we had more infested vegetation than we expected. And so we had less selective removal process and more clearing grub. So for better or worse, this project allowed us to kind of just like remove a lot of infested vegetation, and hopefully we can start fresh. So we do quarterly monitoring, in-house transect and photo monitoring, and then the shothole borer monitoring would be conducted by. And looking ahead, I think just highlighting that we'll take what we learned from phase one and two as it relates to shothole borer and kind of make sure that we remove and solarize, chip, do all the IPMs that are listed for that site. And then I know that my time is like up, so I'm trying to rush through here. So if you have any questions, thank you for your time, but I can take any questions probably in the chat, or you can, or the Q&A, excuse me, or shoot me an email. Thank you. Sorry.
Thanks, Elise. You did a great job. And now we'll move on to our final speaker, talking about replanting at the Disneyland Resort, Rhonda Wood, urban forester at the Disneyland Resort.
Replanting at the Disneyland Resort. Yes, we do it quite a bit. We try not to. Of course, we want our trees to live forever. But when we have to replace, we have a great program that we continue to strive to improve. And a lot of that is due to ISHB and what we experienced in our time with our heaviest infestation. So I'll get to that in a second, but brief overview, just want to talk quick history of the property and just in case anybody hasn't been to Disneyland, and then get into our reforestation program. So history, we built Disneyland in 1955, and here we are today with 16,000 trees. Over 16,000 trees. We have over 600 species, over 600 acres. There's a lot of sixes involved. I'm not sure why. Don't stack them together. We remove and plant about 500 trees, so not 600, about a year. And this is the team that takes care of the forest. It's really all of us, all our horticulture team. That includes an arborist manager with 16 pruners, urban forester, that's me, with 7 tree assessment technicians. We have an irrigation project manager that manages 3 construction tree protection cast members out there, being the Loraxes of our trees. And we have irrigators and water managers, IPM manager, and our IPM plant healthcare technicians. And then, of course, we have a lot of gardeners and 4 landscape managers, and then director and whatnot. So those are who take care of our forest. And getting to the nitty gritty. So our biggest thing, like I said, is we want to keep trees alive. And so to do that, we do a lot of inspecting, maintaining, and then monitoring. And with that, that's risk assessments, tree health assessments, and then maintenance, inspecting for pruning cycles, and then performing those. So our routine tree maintenance would include our pruning, our IPM treatments, our irrigation management, and then, of course, monitoring. That's the biggest thing. From that aspect, it just cycles through, and we monitor that maintenance and inspections on a basis, on a frequency that is, basically designed so that we can have optimum tree health and provide any further mitigation to prevent tree removals. We have a great support system. So we work with our UC team, scientific team. So we've been fortunate enough to have Dr. John Kabashima, Dr. Keith Escalon, and now Dr. Chris Shogren, as well as yeah, so we've had, and Dr. Shannon Lynch, we've had them help in our monitoring, and they have really instilled a more superior monitoring program and inspection program than we had previously, based off of science. So that's, we've been very lucky. This is why, of course, we were not in a bubble. We also experienced the ISHB infestation. We first realized we had ISHB in 2015, at the late stages of 2015. And in 2016, we got our team on board and we started inspecting and monitoring for ISHB. We have a database, luckily, and we're able to record all this information. We went from monitoring 3,000 trees at one point in our highest point of realizing, you know, the trees that are susceptible. So 3,000 susceptible trees. We did that monthly for a couple years. And then through treatment practices, of course, first strategy pruning, protecting wounds after pruning, evaluating, that was our first strategy. And then second strategy would be any chemical treatment that we needed to do. And then if we had to, third strategy was tree and stump removal. Well, we were fortunate we didn't have too much of that. We were able to build up a monitoring program and fund that because we were able to communicate to executives that if we didn't do this, we could potentially lose 3,000 trees. And when you times that by how much it costs to replace a tree at Disneyland and the size that we would only be able to replace them with, it really spoke volumes. And so we were able to fund a program. But getting into the replanting piece. So what we've learned, a lot since that practice is although we had a diverse forest with over 600 species of trees, we needed more. And so we continue to strive for that. And our practices to work with landscape architects to, of course, diversify any project. In our resort, we definitely strive for the industry standard, which is no more than 10% of one species. I'm not sure what our percentage is. Maybe our most percentage might be 7% of one species, but that's as we continue to replant, that number is changing because we're not really planting that species anymore to the degree that we once were. And it's Pinus canariensis, by the way, that's the number one species at Disneyland. We stay current on local pests and disease issues. We have a naughty list, and that means that's sort of just a term that we coined, but basically with different pest and disease issues, we advise our landscape architects with Walt Disney Imagineering to not plant certain species or limit a species. But that's never an absolute. We revisit that list at every project. And so like now that we've had ISHB under more control, like we have introduced back some species, knowing that these trees weren't heavily infested. And so we can introduce those back. We have a good monitoring program, a trapping program that allows us to inspect for ISHB. So, we also look to diversify with and preparing for the future for climate and water restrictions. We had a lot of water restrictions in the past, and we know even though our drought has temporarily luckily we've had all this rain, but it will continue. And so we plan for the future and have looked to diversify with climate ready trees. And then our tree planting process is very important with inspecting trees before they get on site. And that includes rejecting any trees found with pest and disease, and also mechanical issues. So for example, mechanical issues with stake damage, that canker that stake caused by the tree growing and they didn't adjust the nursery stake, that we had seen ISHB in, or disease enter through the canker and had many problems with that. So inspection is very important in the tree planting process. So a case study, this was back when in 2018, during basically the height of our ISHB infestation, or maybe it was approaching that, where we had definitely had a lot of ISHB trees impacted. There's one area in our back of house location where it's called the Team Disney Anaheim building. And that's that building you see on the I-5 freeway that's blue on one side and, it's blue on the inside, green on the outside of where the freeway is. So that's called the Team Disney Anaheim building. And that's where 30,000 cast members go through that corridor and have all our offices for Disneyland. And they see these trees every day. We had 53 Coleoptera that were infested with ISHB in this area. This was actually a great way that Dr. John Kabashima was able to help us advocate for funding. It was right in front of the president of Disneyland's office, where he saw these trees every day. He saw them declining. It's like it was meant to be. If the beetle had to go somewhere, it went to these trees and helped us fund the program. But we ultimately wound up removing 53 trees. We this poster that you see on the right-hand side, that was a way to communicate out to the public, because removing 53 trees wasn't at the time something that people wanted to see. And so we explained the why. And then this is just a little bit about the removal process and the replanting and diversifying. So this is just one particular area out of the 53 trees. We went back in with seven species. So it went from one species that literally was planted over this entire area, and we diversified with seven. This is an example of a parking lot location that was in the same area, the entryway to this Team Disney Anaheim building. They had a uniform, obviously, Coleoptera planting, this monoculture, and so we went in with the parkscape of trying to develop a pattern that would be pleasing aesthetically, but it's definitely diversified. So it's something different than a typical a street tree environment. And so that's just something that, you know, it's not something at Disney that landscape architects want to do. They want to have a uniform streetscape. And so this was a trial. So to see that, like, hey, it could look like a lovely street with beautiful canopy trees. It's still growing, so it's not quite there yet, but it's our demonstration area. And then here's some before and after pictures. So on the left, those are the all the Coleopteras. Of course, we went back in with small trees. Because it was a back of house area, we didn't spend the money that we normally do with big trees inside the park. So we planted 24s and 36s for the most part. And after 5 years, we're starting to see a canopy there. And again, we planted with non-susceptible species to ISHB. So this was particular for that project. And that's what we do. So we continue to, so the basics are, we repeat this process. Our first line of defense is having a good inspection, monitoring, and maintenance program. We have a very extensive effort to design and plan and design for our forest. And then when we do proper tree planting, we have less need to replace trees, and that's our cycle.
Great. Thank you very much. Great presentation. So that wraps up all of our presenters. We're back on schedule, which is just fantastic. I'd like to thank everybody for attending our symposium today. I'd like to thank our presenters. You guys were all just awesome. Thanks also to Cheryl Reynolds and the UCIPM team for hosting this symposium. I'd like to thank LA County Parks and Rec for allowing us to hold tomorrow's field event at Bosque del Rio Hondo Park, which is the southeast end of Whittier Narrows. And also on that, thanks also to the County of Los Angeles Agricultural Commissioner's Office for help in coordinating tomorrow's event. I think that's it. So we'll conclude now.